Hi, I'm Madison Taylor.
And I'm Murphy Griffin.
And welcome to episode 9 of Neophyte Boat Rights. In the last episode, we traveled all the way to Connecticut to pick up a 16-foot long slab of white oak for our keel.
And in this episode, we're going to show you from start to finish how we took that slab and turned it into the keel for the Newfoundland Trap Skiff. So, let's get to it. So the first step in making the keel for the Newfoundland Trap Skiff is a familiar one to any woodworker, and that's wood preparation. We need to mill and roughly dimension the stock before we can actually start cutting it to shape. So when a woodworker takes a rough piece of stock and prepares it, they typically start by jointing one of the faces to get a nice flat reference face. They'll then take it to the planer and plane off the other face, and then they'll joint one edge and then cut off the rest on the table saw so that they have four square faces that are parallel to one another. So unfortunately, we have a 16-foot long slab of white oak that we have to flatten, and we can't just simply pop it up on our small jointer. So instead, we're going to build a flattening jig that'll enable us to flatten one of the faces with a router. So the basic design behind the flattening jig is as follows. So we started by building a base to support the slab of white oak.
The design of the base was more or less improvised. The only criteria was to build something pretty rugged to support the weight of the slab. You definitely don't want the base to sag or flex when you put the slab on it.
We then added a rail on either side. These rails need to be flat all the way down, and they need to be level with one another in order for the jig to work. So once we have the base built with the rails added, we then build a basic sled that will travel along the rails and hold a router.
The sled doesn't amount to much more structurally than just a box without a top. But you do want to make sure that you make it to the correct dimensions so that it overhangs the sides of the base.
So as for the design of the router sled that will be traveling along the rails, it essentially boils down to two features. If we're looking at it from the side, you'll notice that it has these bumpers that are overhanging. Now these wrap around the rails and keep the sled from falling off the rails. And if we're looking at it from the top view, it has a slot that's been routed out of the base of the sled that enables the router bit to reach the slab underneath.
It goes without saying that the bigger the router bit you use, the faster the flattening process will go. So make sure that you make the slot to the right dimension so it can accommodate the size of bit that you'll be using, aka use the same bit to make the slot.
So however you contrive to build and design it, these are the two main features you need: bumpers and a slot. So essentially, we'll just be moving the sled down the rails and moving the router back and forth, flattening the face. We will trim away the rough surface and be left with a flat surface all the way down the slab.
The flattening process was pretty slow and tedious, and as long as you've taken the proper precautions when building the router jig, then you shouldn't have to spend much time thinking about what you're doing. You're just making slow progress. We ended up making about 5 passes over the slab until we got it completely flattened. Each pass taking close to an hour to complete. The keel was a little bit bigger than the base we built, so we had to hand plane the excess. While we were flattening, we discovered a few nails were buried in the slab. So we came back after we'd flattened most of the slab and pulled those nails out, and then power planed the area around them. And so with that, the slab was flattened and it was time to move on to the next step. So we needed to return to the lofting board to make a template to help us cut the keel out of the slab. So we lofted all the necessary details and then set out to make a basic template. Madison traced the keel lofting onto a long strip of drafting film, making sure to pick up important alignment details along the way, like the center line and the station grid lines. Since the keel lofting only has half of the shape of the keel, you have to come up with some way to make a mirror image of that shape. So we folded the drafting film along the center line and then cut the two sides out at the same time. Let's do it. So now it was time to start cutting the keel from the slab. We positioned the template so that we avoided the most defects and got the best piece of wood possible for our keel. And with that, it was time to start cutting the sucker out. At first, we're doing a real rough cut of the keel. We're mainly just trying to reduce the weight so we can move it around more easily. We then retrace the template so that we have a clearer line to cut to. Now we're really taking our time and being really careful to follow the line. Unfortunately, because of the 10-inch blade on the skill saw, we can't make the turns quite as nimbly as we would like. So occasionally we have to come back in with a handsaw and clear out some material so we can change the angle of approach. Nonetheless, this is not the final cut of the keel's shape. We were leaving some room to come back and shape it by hand. With the keel cut roughly the shape, we can now start addressing some of the defects in the wood. When working with large timbers, you'll often encounter any number of defects in the timber. Now, depending on where on the boat and what the function of that timber is, these defects can be dealt with in different ways. When a woodworker encounters a defect in a piece of wood, what they often do is route out that area and fill the void with epoxy. But boat builders don't have that luxury. Instead, what they do is they patch that area with another piece of wood, and they call that piece of wood a dutchman. Now, the most common defects that are encountered in a large timber are knots, checks, and nails, all three of which have to be dealt with in the proper way. So the solution is to identify the defect and route out that area, leaving a void. Now the area that you cut out can be of any shape, it really doesn't matter. But really the idea is that you want to have to replace the least amount of wood. There are two really important considerations when patching an area with a dutchman. One is that the dutchman should be made out of the same species of wood as the surrounding timber. The other is that the grain orientation of the dutchman should follow the flow of the grain of the timber. Now there are good material reasons for doing both of these things. First, you always want to use the same species of wood as the surrounding timber because depending on the species of wood, the wood will expand and contract at different rates. So you want the dutchman to expand and contract at the same rate as the surrounding timber. Secondly, you want to orient the grain in the same flow as the surrounding timber because wood in general expands more along the grain than it does across the grain. So if you don't orient the grain properly, you could end up with undue stress along the joints of your dutchman, which could lead to bigger issues. And so began our dutchman marathon. There was a cluster of knots towards the middle of the timber, as well as a couple more nails. So we set to patching those areas with dutchman. And so, with all the Dutchmen patched in, it was time to send the keel to the planer. Now it's time to plane the keel down to its final thickness. Everything we've done so far has been in preparation for this moment. So we flattened one face of the keel to give us a reference face for the planer. We cut the keel to rough shape so it can fit through the planer. And we made sure to patch all the trouble areas with Dutchmen before planing. Planing the keel was initially tricky because of the slight bow in the timber. But after we got started, it was easy peasy. So the keel was thickness down to 1 3/4 inches. And with that, it's time for us to re-loft a keel for its final shaping.
So with the keel now thicknessed to 1 3/4 inches, we have it roughly cut to the shape that it needs to be, but we need to be more exacting than we have been in the past. So we're using a chalk line to help us figure out where the center line should fall. Now what we're gonna do is we're gonna go down the chalk line and trace little dots along the length of it. We don't wanna snap the line because that's not precise enough. So we're just gonna make little dots along it and then connect all those dots together to get a nice straight line. Okay, now that we've established a center line on the keel, we're gonna go around to all the station marks and draw perpendicular lines to our center line using the compass trick that we showed you in a previous episode.
With the station markings now drawn in, we could plot all the offsets for the inboard and the outboard dimensions of the keel.
So now that we have all the offsets marked for all the 5 station lines and at the forward and the aft perpendiculars, we're going to spring a batten on top of the keel and ferron those points.
So whether you're lofting on a lofting board or lofting on top of the keel, the principle is still the same. You loft the offsets and then connect them together with a batten. But here, instead of using nails, we're using clamps to hold the batten in place. So what Madison and I are lofting on the keel are 2 sets of lines. The inboard or red line that you see, which represents the top of the keel, and the outboard or green line that you see, which represents the bottom of the keel. Up above, you see the half breadth view of the keel, which we've lofted on the lofting board and we based our template off of. Below, you see a cross section of the keel with the red dots representing the inboard dimension and the green dots representing the outboard dimension of the keel, corresponding directly to the red and green lines above. To understand better how the lines in the half-breadth view translate into the 3-dimensional shape of the keel, let's zoom in and see how the cross-section changes as we scan along these lines. So notice that as the inboard and outboard lines get farther apart, that the bevel gets shallower and shallower. The way in which the angle of the bevel changes continuously as we move down the length of the keel makes it what's called a rolling bevel. Besides the rolling bevel, the other key features of the keel are the fixed thickness at 1 3/4 inches and the fixed shoulder dimension at 5/8 inches. All that information together enables us to determine the 3-dimensional shape of the keel. Even though we're lofting on top of the keel, the principles are still the same. You have to take care to make sure that the lines that you're lofting are fair. and consistent with the shape of the lines in the plans. So with the inboard and outboard lines re-lofted on top of the keel, it's finally time for us to get down to shaping this sucker. So now that we have the inboard and the outboard lines lofted for the keel, our next objective will be to bring the wood on the edge here down to this red line. We started off with a power plane to remove the bulk of the material. Careful not to remove too much material so that we have plenty of room to tweak it with hand planes down to a square edge. We then came back in with hand planes to bring it down to the final edge. We found that our compass plane was best suited to this task, since we could change the shape of the sole to conform to the curvature of the edge. It took us a while, but we finally got the edge squared up and down to the line. Okay, so now we've planed down the edge of our keel to meet this red line here, which is the inboard dimension of the keel, and we've also squared the edge up. What this effectively does is transfers the inboard dimension of the keel over to the other side, the top side of the keel. So now what we're gonna do is mark the 5/8 inch shoulder on the edge of the keel that will bevel the edge down to. There's really no magic here. We just took a small combination plane, set it to 5/8 of an inch, and then traced it along the edge. Okay, so the next objective is to carve the bevel out of the edge of our keel here. What we're gonna aim to do is connect the green line to the purple line with a flat face. So we'll come back in with a variety of tools to try to remove all this material and connect the green line to the purple line. Now, if we follow along, you'll notice that the green line and the purple line get steadily closer together. And this is what makes this a rolling bevel. So as the lines get closer together, the bevel gets steeper and steeper and steeper until you get down to 90 degrees. Now, it may not look like much, but there's a lot of material to remove. So we started off with a broad axe and then came back through with a hatchet to chunk out a lot of the material. But we weren't really satisfied with the level of control that we had with the axes, so we came back through with a power plane and belt sander to do the majority of the work. With the bulk of the material removed, we came back through with a 4-inch slick to do a lot of the precision work. It may look like a big menacing chisel, but it's actually really accurate. Finally, we came back through with a compass plane to do the final flattening of the bevel. It really is the perfect tool for the job. So we worked both sides of the keel in the same way until we were satisfied with its shape.
Okay, now that Madison and I have done the vast majority of the shaping on the keel, the next order of business is to seal the wood. There's a couple different ways to do this effectively, but the tried and true and time-honored method is red lead primer. The concept behind priming the wood is to lock in the moisture content of the wood. It right now is open to the elements, and so water and heat are making the wood move around and do some things that we don't want it to do, so we want to help stabilize it. The lead content in the red lead primer helps to fight against critters and fungus and wood rot. So this is a really necessary thing to use on a wooden boat. So typically we're going to want to do two coats, and the first coat we're going to thin with naphtha to help the red lead primer penetrate the wood better.
So it's important that we don't get any red lead primer on the bevel itself. This is supposed to be a wood-to-wood joint, and it only becomes watertight when it swells with taking up water, so we taped off that area. Otherwise, we followed a pretty standard procedure, sanding down the area that's to be painted, cleaning it off with some mineral spirits, and then painting on two coats. And with the last coat of red lead primer, the keel was finished.
So that was episode 9. In the next episode, we'll be showing you how we made the 5 molds for the Newfoundland Trap Skiff.
If you guys are enjoying the series, don't forget to like and subscribe below and check out our Patreon, where you can become a patron and continue helping to fund these episodes.
And on that note, we've got one new patron, much thanks to
Russell Heath.
Thanks.
Bye.